Okay, so we have seen in the last section that there is this geodesic distance, meaning that if we have two points x and y in a weak Riemannian manifold, we have this pseudo distance dist xy, which takes the infimum over all curves which are piecewise C1 and connect x and y, and then we are integrating from 0 to 1 square root of g ct c dot t c dot t dt, right? So this is the geodesic distance, and since we are interested in this distance, it might be prudent to study curves which are of shortest length. Between 2 points. And well, again, sort of the trivial example. So if we have a Hilbert space, then obviously the solution to this is the curve gamma t, which has a property that it connects 2 points B and A like this. So we have a piece of a linear well, a fine linear subspace. So this an H is the shortest curve between A and B from the perspective of the Hilbert space. I mean, this is not deep, obviously. So let's just observe the following thing. So if I'm computing now the distance with respect to this Hilbert space as a strong Riemannian metric, as a strong Riemannian manifold, so what you can prove, and this is an exercise to actually prove that this is true, whenever I take T and S, let's say in the reals, the distance between these 2 points on the curve is given by, well, first of all, I need to take the norm of the derivative, and then I multiply it with the distance between those two things. Thus, the curve gamma realizes the shortest distance between any 2 points on the curve. So this is actually, I mean, this property, which we just singled out here, if you're familiar with metric geometry, this can be used as a definition of a geodesic. So up to this constant. And we can could get rid of this constant by rescaling V minus A. This is the geodesic property from metric geometry. Okay, and I mean we are here on a Hilbert space, so nothing fancy is happening. So this is just a property of a straight line. We will be defining later on geodesics in this Riemannian context, and the point will be that these geodesics are supposed to define to describe curves of shortest length, at least locally. And before we go there, let me explain to you why I'm always insisting on this at least locally stuff. So let's take a nice finite dimension manifold, namely the sphere, right? And so I am looking at the North Pole. Let's take the South Pole downstairs here. And I mean, we saw a similar picture already a little bit before. So we cannot just take the straight line because then we are leaving the sphere. But what you can prove if you're endowing this sphere with the remaining metric coming from the ambient space there, and you're computing the length of the curves on it. So there is a curve which is realizing these shortest distances. And this curve is given by something which is called a great circle, right? So you're basically connecting these two things with the curve which runs down here. First of all, we see that this curve, which is realizing the shortest distance, is at least in this case not unique. I mean, I can take basically any other great circle. So let's perhaps take one which goes exactly the opposite way around. So this goes around the back. And well, just from the picture, well, what we can think of if we have a sensible metric there, which comes from the ambient space, the length of the orange and the red curves should be the same. Okay, so here there are, I mean, in Hilbert spaces, we have a unique curve between two points, which is realizing the shortest distance. At least on the sphere, we get, in this case, infinitely many, which do that. So this is the first problem. However, so if I'm starting at this point, all of the points which lie on the red circle have the property that if I'm following this this red great circle, then this red great circle is realizing the shortest distance, say, between the North Pole and any other point which lies on this red on this red circle. So, for example, if I'm taking let's say this green point here, then the shortest way from the North Pole down there is following the red line. However, I mean, if I'm just let me just wrongly write draw this thing draw this thing slightly besides the other great circle we have here. So let's assume it goes around in this. So I can, of course, follow the curve. And when I take an element which lies then on the other side of the circle, let's say, for example, here. Well, okay, now this looks like it's not lying on the orange one. But obviously, there will be shorter ways now from the North Pole to the black cross. I should have not been going first around the right hemisphere and then through the North Pole, through the South Pole, and then up again. But instead, I should have probably followed something like this orange line here towards the black cross, and this would have realized the shortest distance. And while this red curve realizes the shortest distance from the North Pole to everything which lies on the red line, where the red line is not dashed, after the South Pole, it stops being the shortest connection to the North Pole, and then other geodesics are doing this. But so what will turn out, this these great circles, they are always, so this is, this turns out to be a geodesic, which is only locally length minimizing. What I mean by length minimizing is that it realizes the shortest distances, a distance between two points. Okay, and so we will generalize this this concept of a length minimizing curve. So there are actually several ways of describing what you mean by a geodesic. And we will see that we can define such a notion of geodesic also for weak Riemannian manifolds. And the question is, of course, does it exist? So first approximation. Geodesic is something like a locally length minimizing curve. meaning that between two points on the curve, it realizes the shortest distance between those two things. And okay, if this is locally length minimizing, what this means is, well, we can take a variational approach to this. We can say GOD6 are thus critical points of the energy, sort of the length functional. Right, so we're basically searching for the infimum over the length of a curve C in gamma xy, for example. And we're asking, and every extremal point of this hopefully differentiable guy here, so it should be a GOD6 then. Okay, then usually, because if we recall that the length involved something like an integral, okay, integral is not so bad, but then we have a square root of something. We want to get rid of the square root, and what one usually does, applying, we have seen that this nice little trick where we have the energy functional, we have this estimate for the 4.1, which says that the square of the length functional is dominated by the energy functional. So we use the energy functional. Instead. So this is not an if and only if condition, but it's usually much more convenient to work with the energy differential. So we are in the spirit of variational calculus. What we do is we are derivating into the energy functional. So let's just do it formally. We are we are not really doing a variational approach here. This is only just motivation I want to be giving you. So we are differentiating at a curve C into the direction of h, and let's assume we know for some reason that we are allowed to interchange integration and differentiation. So what we get then by the usual rules is we get GC the Riemannian metric at CT of C dot applied to H dot plus 1/2 the differential of the Riemannian metric. So this is a smooth function, which is nice, CH, and then I have to evaluate CT dot CT dot. Right, so we get a derivative inside of the Riemannian metric, and actually, this is just using the rule on partial derivatives. Remember that the energy function had actually a 1/2 in front of it, and the 1/2 is eating the 2, which should be written here in front of the first contribution, because we are differentiating into the first component of the Riemannian metric. We're differentiating into the second component. The result is both times by symmetry of the Riemannian metric, because it's a symmetric bilinear form. It's GCT of C dot and so forth. So we would get 2 times GCT of C dot H dot. And the 1/2 is actually killing this. And then the last thing we have to do, we are thinking of the Riemannian metric here because it's defined on the Whitney sum as a mapping in 3 variables. So this C here is the base point variable where we differentiate the Riemannian metric, and then we have the 2 vector variables which are given by CT. Okay, and so to find the geodesic, we would have to isolate H in the above expression. So this means rewrite the differential in the following form. We want to rewrite it as integral from 0 to 1 g at some point c of something, and then an h, dt. And here, since we are saying this is an extremal point, we would require that this is zero. And so this expression would then lead to something which is called the geodesic equation. Now, on finite dimensional manifolds, this is in principle possible to always do this. Whether you can do it practically and figure out what the equation then needs to be is a completely different question. But in principle, we can do this. So this works, let's say, on strong Riemannian manifolds. Since the flat map, which we studied in the other lecture, is surjective. Or actually, it's an isomorphism. And so in principle, it's possible to extract from this data then the geodesic equation. I mean, computational questions aside. So we know that since this flat map here is not an isomorphism for weak Riemannian metrics, well, in general, it's not an isomorphism for weak Riemannian metrics, this might be impossible for weak Riemannian metrics. So these the geodesic equation, at least when it comes to these length minimizing things, they it might just be that you cannot reformulate this as a as an equation which you can pose on your tangent space. And the reason for this is, again, this failure of this connection between the space and its dual space via the flat map. So the flat map is not strong enough to always give this to us. This is a shame, especially because of the following example. So you might ask, okay, very nice. So geodesics are curves of shortest length. So what is the point of all this? Well, okay, maybe we cannot find curves of shortest length. That's probably not shocking because we know that there are metrics with vanishing geodesic distance. So we've seen that. And so let me give you an example of a Riemannian metric with vanishing geodesic distance, where we have nevertheless interesting geodesics. So, and this is the Inviskid-Burgers equation. And we have seen that if we're putting on diff S1, the L2 metric, the invariant one, is a weak Riemannian metric with vanishing geodesic distance. This was the Michel-Mumford result. However, one can work out its geodesic equation and it corresponds to the Inviskid-Burgers equation. Also called Hopf equation. And let me just give you, so this is a partial differential equation, which reads ut plus 3 u ux. The subscripts here, contrary to what I'm usually using, is partial differentials. So in the notation which I've used is dt u plus 3 u dx u, where u is something which has a time variable, let's say from 0 to t, times the reals and spits out in the reals. And actually, I'm cheating here a little bit. I'm writing this down in the real formulation. Actually, I should have been writing this down as an equation on the circle on S1. Then I would use something called a covariant derivative, which we'll see in the next chapter. And so the point of this is, this leads to something called Euler-Arnold theory. So you can, one can study certain PDE as geodesic equations of weak Riemannian matrix on infinite dimensional manifolds. So this Inviskid-Burgers equation, which I've just given you, this is of course a PDE on a finite dimensional vector space. On the geodesic equation of a weak Riemannian matrix, this is an ordinary differential equation on an infinite dimensional manifold, which might not have solutions, right? We have seen this chapter that there are certain very well-behaved or very nicely looking ordinary differential equations, which nevertheless do not admit a solution because we are outside of Banach spaces. So, and it turns out that this Inviskid-Burgers equation is exactly on the nose, the geodesic equation for this invariant L2 metric. And now you might scratch your head a little bit because when you think 5 minutes back, I said, well, geodesics are curves which are locally length minimizing, right? So we should locally have that they are curves of shortest length. Now we know that this invariant L2 metric has a property that the geodesic distance vanishes. So does that mean all of the geodesics have to be constant? Because then only constant curves can have length zero, or what's going on? So actually this is related to something so the geodesics we get here in this setting for the weak invariant L2 are basically do not have this property that they are length minimizing with respect to this invariant metric, but instead they satisfy the geodesic equation, and this geodesic equation can also be described in other ways than via this energy estimate thing I've shown you up here, right? So and this is what the next chapter is about. So we will be looking into a certain number of equivalent formulations of this geodesic property and try to understand what actually is a geodesic and how could you in principle compute them. And we'll do this first in the stronger setting, namely we are doing it for strong Riemannian metrics. I mean, the upshot of this whole thing is of this informal discussion, the moment the idea you should have geodesics should somehow be curves which are very nice because they are locally length minimizing. They are, in a certain sense, the generalization of a straight line from let's say, Hilbert space setting to the manifold setting. So they should be something like straight lines. And the last example shows that on one hand, these geodesic equations are interesting, say, for example, if you're interested in PDEs or if you're interested in application to shape analysis. So we'll see an application of that tomorrow. However, what the last thing implies, or where you should raise an eyebrow is, or where this hints at, is that geodesic can be defined using a different set of conditions, and at least say for this for this invariant L2 metric, you have geodesics which then turn out not to be locally length minimizing, because that doesn't make sense because of the vanishing geodesic distance, right? But they have a different property, and okay. Anyway, so let's see in the next chapter how we can define these geodesics, what are the different things in attached to different structures attached to a Riemannian metric, which allows us to describe geodesics.